family and friends, we are so grateful that you have determined to join us in worship through this stream today. We are grateful to God for you and invite you to just simply open your heart and lift up your voice today as God gives you ability as we celebrate worship of our God today, and we are led by our children and youth as we celebrate Youth Sunday. God bless you, and thank you for joining us at New Hope.
Raise your voice and say, hallelujah. Sing,
hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns.
Sing,
hallelujah.
God bless you, family. We're so thankful for this opportunity to return our tithes and our offerings. We're so grateful for your continued faithfulness in giving in this challenging time, and want to remind you that we're grateful to be able to announce that our congregation has made a conscious decision to return a 10% tithe to the congregation's needs and the community, meaning the members of the fellowship who may be in need and those in our surrounding community. We intend to tithe into those needs. to ensure that we can use the resources that we collectively possess to be a blessing to the individual fellowship and individuals in the community around us. We thank you for your giving, and now you can return your tithes and offerings in a number of different ways. You can return those tithes and offerings through the church website at newhopechurchdenver.org on our give page through a secure PayPal link there. You can also give on the church through the church giving app, downloadable giving app, givelify.com on your handheld or mobile device. You can give by simply mailing in your tithe or offering to the church office at 3701 Colorado Boulevard, Denver, Colorado, 80205. And finally, you can give by contacting a member of our finance committee who will kindly come and retrieve your contribution that it may be added to the resources with which we glorify the name of God by continuing to sustain the ministry God's given us by being a blessing to members in need through this crisis and to the surrounding community as we prepare ourselves for recovery. God bless you for your faithfulness and your continued giving back to God at New Hope Baptist Church.
Good morning, New Hope. I am excited to be bringing this morning's litany.
It comes to us based on Luke chapter 2, verse 16 through 21. I will read a passage, and you will read a response, and we will read the last line together. Let's get started. As Advent season fades in our rearview mirror, may we be reminded of the inclusive nature of the gospel. May our testimonies read like those of the shepherds, everything appearing as our Savior declared. As we reflect on an unusual Advent season of online pageantry, social distancing, and strained celebration, may this reading of the gospel remind us that everyone has a seat at God's table. May their show of faith, expectation, and commitment displayed by leaving their posts in the middle of their evening shifts inspire us to leave everything for the gospel of Jesus. We pray that our 2020 worship experiences reflect the thankfulness we have to celebrate, even in hard and unusual circumstances. We pray to see you in unexpected places. We pray to have the commitment to chase after you and the thoughtfulness to spread an inclusive gospel. Together, may we run to spread the liberating gospel of Jesus. God bless you.
To praise the Lord, we have come to lift him up. We have come to magnify him. Come on, let's worship him. Praise the Lord. Lift him up.
Family, we're thankful on this Youth and Young Adult Sunday, the final worship Sunday of the year, for this marvelous opportunity to gather together in worship. So we thank God today for the worship that's going forth, praise and worship that has ushered us into the presence of God, for the litany shared, for the scripture that's been read, and for you gathering from wherever you are. Allow me to just thank God for you. What a wonderful year God has blessed us to receive in worship amid all the challenges we have faced around us. I thank God today for your faithfulness, for your commitment to worship week after week, day through the week, through the day, that so many are signing on long after Sunday is over. We're grateful today that many of you sign on Mondays and Wednesdays, on Thursdays and Saturdays. As your schedule permits, as life unfolds, you continue to seek the face of God in worship. I thank God for you that through all the travail of navigating a global pandemic, an experience like we have never, ever seen in history, I am so grateful for your faithfulness to God. And so we praise God for you today and thank God for how you have journeyed faithfully throughout a traumatic year. You ought to just pause right here and thank God. I thank God for you, and I invite you to just thank God for God's faithfulness along your side. God bless you as we turn our hearts and minds to the Word. I'll just reiterate a few of those words that have been read and you're hearing for Scripture today. From that second chapter according to Matthew in verses 9 through 12. Here's what it says there. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star that they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. And on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped Christ. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another way. Amen? Let's pray together. God, we just thank you today for this wonderful opportunity to worship your holy name. We ask now, God, that you would guide this moment of praise, worship, and preaching. That God, that you would keep us in the hollow of your unchanging hand, that Lord, we might remove ourselves from any distractions around us, that we may be able to be centered in your word. God, we need your word. It's a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathways. And God, without your word, we know not where we'd go. So be with us right now, God, in the name of Jesus. And we declare that as your word goes forth, your people will give your name praise. Amen. I'll be preaching from this subject today, Another Way Home. Another Way Home. The second chapter of Matthew's gospel invites us to rewind the most anticipated event in history, bigger than the Jets finally winning a game and Candace's notebook in The Real Housewives of Potomac. This is the birth of Christ, the newborn king. Among well-wishers in the barn-turned-delivery room, few were more known on this historic day than these magi. From Broadway shows to Baptist hymnals, the magi inhabit our hearts with the story of Christ's birth. While their names are conjectured, their origins are approximations, and even their number are actually unrecorded, we do know they'd come to see the star. We and these wise men have so much in common. After all, no one knows where God brought us from. God did change our names, and only God knows the number of second chances we are made of. Yet, like these wise men, we began a journey toward the light. Matthew's subjects had heard of a star so bright that scientists hypothesized it as a comet, a conjunction of planets, or an exploding supernova that illuminated the eastern hemisphere. Like them, we heard something and wanted to see it. We were told about something and wanted to experience it. Where someone sensed something around us or in us, and we wanted to prove it to be God. Somewhere along our search, like these three kings, our inquest met with indwelling, an investigation met with conviction, and we realized God is real. Anyone remember waking up for the first time it came to your remembrance and understanding, and you concluded that that was the day the Lord had made, and in your own way, you decided, I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it. Just like these wise men, the closer they got to the star, the more they abandoned abandoned their inquiry and pursued their convictions. That's how you and I arrived where we are with God today. We were convicted by something. We gave some stuff up. We put some things aside, sensed a purpose, embraced a calling, a move from God began, and you and I took the journey toward the light. Despite that journey, family, as it was with these magi, darkness was waiting where they come from. Herod had entwined them in an evil plot with intentions to take the newborn king's life. He requested that when they found the baby Jesus, they'd report to him the location. And as faithfully as we worship on the Sunday stream and lean toward the light, like these wise men, there is some darkness still around us. Despite 300,000 deaths from COVID-19, politicization of its resolve is all around us. Though police and community have taken steps, we saw a black woman in Chicago detained while naked in her own home all around us. And in a year when we've had months to ponder better ways of being, we still have old issues hoping to hold us hostage. Old tactics, former ways, stuff we cut loose in the convicting experience of a global pandemic will reattach itself if we're not diligent. This is why I thank God that once you've met the Christ child like these magi, you're able to see through new spiritual lenses and grasp there just might be another way home. And that's how these wise men determined to complete their journey toward the light. That's how they decided that though we've been told one thing, God has something else in store. Though they'd gotten specific instructions from the king himself, they realized there's a greater authority. And because of that one, we're going to choose another way home. Anyone on the stream who knows you didn't survive 10 months of a global pandemic with a deadly disease just to go back to what you used to do? Is it a brother or a sister in worship today who's confident that God brought you through too much this year for you to pour God's new energy into old approaches? Is there anybody who realized that you worked too hard, you prayed too fervently, you reflected on God and God's way for your life so sincerely, you adapted new ways and protected your family, you avoided COVID or overcame it, and now as you look back at these 9 months where you come from, you realize that it will do you no good at all. It will negate God's blessing if you just go back the way you came, and you realize right here and now you need another way home. So the question is, how do we arrive at such an outcome? How do we find another way home? Here it is in the text. Verse 12 teaches us these wise men were warned in a dream and responded accordingly. This means, family, you can identify another way home if you receive the revelation God's sending. In other words, it was revealed to them that they had to take another way home. It was revealed to them that they had to take a new route, to take up a new direction, to change the plans on the map. And more than just testify about God speaking to them, more than signify they hear from the Lord on a regular basis, they decided that we're going to receive what God has sent. They had to travel different terrain, adjust their navigation on the fly, face fears of the unknown, and abandon what they knew. Yet they took another way home. And trust me, just like you, I had ministry work all mapped out for the year. I had a good idea about God's plan and what was required, so I thought. Yet God saw fit to permit everything around us to change so drastically that at this point, getting Christ's light to others requires we receive revelation. We, like these wise men, have had some deep human problems to solve. We got now the task of presenting the church to an church culture. We got not to mention learning what it means to build disciples outside a building. Our work at this juncture and getting the message of Jesus Christ home to the world around us requires you and I to receive revelation. Like these wise men, God needs to know we've taken possession of divine guidance. We have received his instruction. We've taken hold of what he's intuited to us that we can put it into practice and carry
it out. Reminds me of delivery drivers through the pandemic who were required to confirm receipt of your groceries, your meal, or your parcel post that you ordered online or by phone. They would arrive at your doorstep, drop off the package, and then take a cell phone picture of their delivery and send the image to you and their hiring authority as confirmation they delivered what you need. Well, there's somebody on the stream today who you need to look back over your last 9 months and you'll realize that God has sent you specific confirmation that he delivered what you needed, that God sent you revelation. And as a matter of fact, over these months, as we've seen unrest all around us, as we've seen spiritual apathy increase, racial violence explode, closing of churches, all land at our doorstep, they are confirmation through the revelation of God and the movement of this word around us that you and I, if the word of God, if the Son of Jesus, Son of God in Jesus Christ is going to be revealed, you and I have to receive the revelation. We can't do what we've always done and expect to get new outcomes than what we always had. You and I have got to be willing to lean ourselves to God, to list our ear to the Lord, to open ourselves, our hearts, and our souls to new ways of life, ministry, meaning, and relationship if we're going to make this new way home. And it begins by receiving God's revelation. Once we've done that, family, these wise men show us we've got to take the risk required. In the 12th verse, scripture says that they made the decision to go home after having seen the Christ child and being impacted by his presence. They decided to go home by another route. The Magi's decision to take another route was against the wishes of one who was as evil and maniacal as they come. Not returning to Herod was a great risk. Herod the Great, as he named himself, you got to read this when you get time, appointed his brother-in-law high priest, and when the people applauded the brother-in-law, Herod ordered his accidental drowning. Herod once appointed one of his uncles to serve as security to his wife while he was away on a trip, and when a mere rumor spread that his uncle had said something inappropriate to his wife, the uncle went missing. Herod secretly hired a hitman, this is true, on his wife in case a political bid he sought was unsuccessful. Well, the bid succeeded, but because his wife found out about the hitman, Herod executed a hit on the hitman. True story. He eventually took that wife out and her mama. Herod had two sons left after that, but too bad for them because he didn't want anybody threatening his throne, so he executed them too. What I'm trying to tell you is when they took another way home, they had taken a calculated risk for Christ's sake. And I came by to tell somebody, you don't have a hit out on your head, I hope. Hopefully, there is no threatening authority raining down over your mortal life and well-being. But what is at stake is the witness of Christ going forth into the world and the will of God for your life coming to pass. And if those things are going to happen, if you're going to take a new way home at the beginning of this year that is ahead of us, you and I have got to take the risk required. That means, family, that you and I have got to do some new things for God. We got to determine that we can't just return to the way of life as we always done it. Return to your way of life differently than how you got to this point requires a risk. As Herod did, the wise men, scenarios along the way we've come encountered with will squelch the light. Issues along that old route will steal our joy. Ridiculous rulers who are still around will threaten to storm our cities. If we'll go another way home, we got to take the risk required. Don't turn back. Reset your GPS. Delete the numbers you no longer need. Throw away the stuff that holds ungodly influence over you and trust God enough to take the risk required. You say, Pastor, I've been doing this a long time this way, but you have to find that if you found out, you don't know how good God really is until you trust what God can really do. Can I get any witnesses who will testify that when you took the time to take the risk required for Christ's sake, when you took God by the hand and trusted, Lord, where you lead me, as the song says, I'll follow, you found out how good God really was and how true God was to God's word. I just want to thank the Lord today that when I've taken risks for Christ's sake, when I've stepped out and when you've stepped out to see what the end would be with what God declared, you learned that God was no shorter than his word. Can we get did one worshiper who will thank God today that when you take the risk required for Christ, you can make another way home. Oh, thank God. And then finally, family, I'm through when I tell you this, that if we're going to make another way home, we got to change more than the map. The Magi returned to the same country that they left a different way. But they weren't the same. They returned to the same geographic location, but not the same way that they went. They embarked for home, but were different than when they left. They didn't walk, talk, or think the same, because remember, they had been with Christ, the newborn king. They had been in the presence of the Son of the living God. They changed more than the map. And they weren't the first to do so. The Bible tells us a long lineage, a history of those who'd come in contact with the Lord, and it changed them from the inside out. Why? They changed more than the map. You remember Jacob, don't you? He wrestled with God at the river Jabbok. The Bible says he wrestled with God all night long. And at the end of that night, he got up and he looked this godly being in the eye. And the godly being said, "What's your name, brother?" He said, "My name is Jacob." He said, No, you wrestled with God and men and prevailed. So from now on, your name's going to be Israel." God changed Jacob's name. You remember Naomi, don't you? She lost her husband and all of her sons. She turned to her good friend Ruth and said, "Call me Mara, because it means I'm bitter." Ruth said, "Don't be bitter, sister girl." She said, "Where you go, I'll go. Your people will be my people and your God will be my God." Right then and there, and the days that proceeded afterward, Ruth changed Naomi. His life. You remember David, don't you? David's job as a child was simply protecting the sheep. And one day he heard a giant named Goliath threatening the whole nation of Israel. And David rose up and realized, "I got 5 smooth stones and God with me. I can take down this giant named Goliath." David did so, and it changed the trajectory of his life. You remember Joshua? Anybody remember Joshua, who arrived at the Jordan River as no more than the right-hand man to Moses? But yet Moses, the Bible said, had died. And God said, "Joshua, the promise I made to Moses, I'll keep with you." Joshua followed God's promise, and he learned that his willingness to do so changed his assignment for the rest of his life. Anybody remember Sarah, who laughed at Abraham and God and said, "Ain't no way no baby come out of here at this age of my life." Yet Sarah remained a living witness, and God did allow Abraham and Sarah to conceive at elder age, and she was changed from being a pessimist to a parent. Anybody remember Naaman? Naaman was a general in the army who had leprosy and went to the prophet and said, "Oh prophet, if your God is so good and great, won't you help me be healed of my condition?" The prophet said, "Go to the pool of Siloam and wash 7 times." Naaman said, "What? What kind of healing is that?" Naaman begrudgingly went down to the pool, washed 7 times, and the Bible says he was healed from the bottom to the top of his body. He went back and said, "Surely your God is God." I don't know about you, anybody, but it seems like to me, if all through the word of God, we can look back and see the testimonies of those who changed more than the map, then you and I have got some great change to make in our lives. Is there anybody here who will thank God today as you look back at these months gone by over this crazy cataclysmic year, that you can still realize that because of all you've endured, all God's brought you over, all God's carried you through, that what God's trying to tell your family is, this provides you another way home. Don't go back the same way you came. Don't just redo what you did last January. You ought to trust God enough to take another way home. You ought to change more than the map, family. You ought to decide today that God can help you make change that'll change not just your direction, but who you are in this life. You ought to trust God enough to take the risk required. You ought to know that there's going to be some risk in taking another way home, but if you trust in God, I believe he'll see you through. And then finally, you got to receive God's revelation. And once you've done it, I'm a living witness, you can chart another course home. That, oh yeah, you can get to the destination God has. You can accomplish the goals and dreams God promised you, but you may need to take another way home. And don't you worry about how long it takes to get there, because the story says that the wise men, Joseph and Mary, all got to their destinations. Why? Because as they traveled, the Lord went with them. Is there anybody who knows that every now and then in life, you've been some different routes than what you planned, but you got to where you were going because the Lord was with you. We need another way home. There's no need in us repeating these last 12 months. Oh, we've seen unrest like never in my lifetime. We have seen upheaval of governing bodies and legislation in our country like probably not in 20, 30 years. We've seen division between races and cultures and communities. We've seen inequities in wealth, health, culture, social provisions and justice like not in a decade or more. You and I have got to make a decision right now and today that God is making an instrument of this moment to declare to you and I in the same way God did to these wise men. No matter how great what you have back where you were is, if you're going to receive what I have for you in what you possess, you got to take another way home. And this another way home is a new beginning for you. The good news is that just as you are, the Bible, the song says, just as I am without one plea, meaning that we come to God just as we are, that this is the starting point to your another way home, that God is not expecting you to be who you're going to be right now. What God wants you to do is receive his revelation. Take the risk of making the change in your life and let God change more than your map. And God will give you, I promise, and declare another way home. And I think there are some folks on the stream right now. I want to ask you right now, if you're worshiping with us by YouTube, if you're on the telephone line, I need you to take this moment right where you are and begin to testify to someone who may be listening or watching that they may receive God's call on their life. You say, Pastor, I know everybody here. No, you don't. See, the stream ID only shows those who are signed in through YouTube. It only shows those who subscribe, those names who have accounts. But there are hundreds of other folks who watch and listen. And our role, yours and mine, is to call them to Christ. So I want to ask you right now in the name of Jesus to take this moment right now where you are, to, if it's no more than 2-3 lines, to testify that someone else who is streaming this worship experience might receive your word from God through you and find Christ for their lives. Why? Because every last one of us needs another way home. We invite you today. I'm going to give you a moment right now to testify. Take this time. Take this as an opportunity for you and I together. Let's extend this invitation to relationship with Jesus Christ. And as it's extended, as worshipers are typing and texting and sharing and commenting and posting, I want to share with you, family, those who are watching, worshipers with us, visiting with us, those who have tuned in to see just what God may have for you. You can connect with us by our Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram pages. You can contact us by leaving a comment in the comment section on this YouTube channel or the public comment box on our YouTube channel. Subscribe, like one of our platforms, and or send us an email, contact us by phone in the church office, because we know and believe that all of us every once in a while need another way home. And surely as this year ends and another one begins, God has something new in store for us if we're willing to take another way home. God bless you, family, and may heaven smile upon us all.
Good morning, New Hope. Please bow with me, whether literally or figuratively, as we pray to God together this morning. In this season of Advent, as we eagerly anticipate the coming of your promise, we know, dear God, that you are present with us even in our waiting. This Advent season, we are also navigating multiple pandemics, infectious outbreaks that threaten our very existence. But the Advent season reignites within us the audacity to believe that even in the midst of tribulation, you are inclined to divine intervention. And where you intervene, where you show up, where you make your power known, things change and miracles happen. Where you are, there is hope. Where you are, there is peace. Where you are, there is joy. Where you are, there is love. Where you are, there is healing. Wherever you are, there is salvation. May this season remind us of all of those things and of all that is possible with you. May this season remind us that Christ came to bring good news to the oppressed, to liberate the captives, to comfort those who are mourning. May this season remind us of the depth and breadth of Christ's concern for the human condition. And I pray today that you would help us to hold fast to all that we are reminded of in this season of Advent and at Christmas time. And that you would allow those things, hope and peace and joy and love, to linger in our hearts, to linger in our minds, to linger in our spirits in the days beyond. And that you would strengthen us as we strive to carry these things into the new year. Strengthen us as individuals, God. Strengthen us as families, given and chosen. Strengthen us as New Hope, a community of faith. God who knows, God who stays, God who can, God who hears, God who keeps. We thank you for the ways that you have made yourself known to us, and await the ways that you will continue to do so in this season and beyond. In the name of the coming Christ, we do pray. Amen.
Well, family, we thank God for you today. We're so grateful you have joined us. We praise the Lord for your presence in this worship stream. As you go, we want to remind you to like this worship experience on the YouTube channel, to subscribe to our channel, to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, that we can remain in contact with you as God continues to join us together in the journey of ministry. We're thankful for those who've dialed in by phone, who streamed in on YouTube, and encourage you to continue to connect with us as God so leads you. We're grateful to God for you and praise the Lord for your presence. And we invite you now to bow with us as we share a word of benediction, after which we want to invite you to hang back a few minutes in the YouTube comment box, to stay a moment on the telephone line, that we might fellowship together as we close out this final Sunday of 2020. Let's bow together for a word of benedictory prayer. Oh God, we just thank you for all you've done for us, all you've shown us, and all you've seen us through. We thank you for this year gone by, oh God, and with it, oh, both its challenges and its blessings. And so, God, we ask right now in the name of Jesus that you go with us and remain between us until we so shall gather again. Guide us, oh God, as we look forward to worshiping on Watch Night Eve, as we look, oh God, over into the new year. Prepare our hearts and minds for that wonderful experience of worship with you on New Year's Eve. But until then, God, bless God and go with us, and we'll be careful to give you all honor, glory, and praise. In the majestic name of Jesus, we pray. And God's people say together, amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. Would you take a moment to fellowship right where you are, virtually or on phone lines, that we may be connected together in Christ. God bless you, and I'll see you on New Year's Eve. Thank you.